Well, we are, as you know, pursuing our continuing studies of the history of God's work through His people. And we have just now finished up what we're going to say about the 17th century. So we've looked both at the beginnings of the American experiment. We looked at the three companies that were founded under James and Charles. And And then we've also looked at what took place in England. So we've looked at the Stuart era in English history, and that's as much as we're going to cover. So we're moving now officially today to the 18th century, the 1700s. And the first character that I'd like to take up in your thoughts along with mine on this topic is this remarkable character who really in some ways represents the end of and also the pinnacle of the Puritan movement in America and in some ways in England as well. So this character, Jonathan Edwards, who is one of the most controversial, misunderstood geniuses in the history of the world, I would say. I remember many of you are old enough to recall this. I don't know if it's still the case. I'll have to hear from somebody who knows about this. But I know that at least when I was back in high school, virtually every anthology of American literature included the most famous sermon preached in American history, known as Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. And I do remember myself reading that sermon and thinking, wow, you know, every week these Puritans would go to church and these hellfire damnation sermons would be preached, and you can imagine Edwards pounding the pulpit and scaring people into faith, that kind of thing, you know. And that was kind of my impression, and nobody did anything to change that impression. That was more or less the idea, and I think most students my age who read Edwards had that as well. Now, I would have read him fairly sympathetically. I mean, I was part of a evangelical, you know, fairly conservative Christian church and denomination at the time, and so I would have read Edwards with a certain degree of sympathy, and yet that was kind of my impression of him. And I don't know that I had any reason to change that until in the late 70s, I had the opportunity to do some graduate work at Eastern. And I discovered a man out there, and I'm going to mention his name because he's a beloved professor of mine. It was quite an accident. I would say a providential fortuity, if there is such a thing, that I came across this fellow. His name is J. William T. Youngs. And he was a Harvard PhD who had studied under the immediate influence of one of the most well-known Harvard scholars of the 40s and 50s and maybe even the 60s, a man by the name of Perry Miller. And Perry Miller was really singularly responsible for rediscovering the Puritans. There had been a pretty widespread, I will call it caricature, of the Puritans that had persisted down through American history, and they were viewed more or less as dour, sour, colorless, legalistic people who were very nervous if you cracked a smile, let alone were having a good time. You know, that was the impression that people had of the Puritans. And, of course, reading the sermon by Jonathan Edwards didn't do much to rectify the impression. The impression was that this is kind of the way in which this culture operated and the way in which these people thought, and Edwards was sort of the great example of it. Perry Miller sort of came across Puritan writings in general and especially came across the writings of Jonathan Edwards and realized we have completely missed what these people, and especially this man, were really all about. And he wrote a book, a biography, which was a seminal work, and it was simply entitled Jonathan Edwards. And it kindled a renewal, a renaissance of interest in the Puritans that all took place largely in the scholarly academic world. Harvard, Yale, and certain other of those Ivy League schools that really trace their history back to the Puritan era decided maybe we should take another look, and they did. And the discoveries they made were absolutely astonishing to them. What to me is a rather ironic and sad thing is that this renewal of interest in the Puritans has largely been contained in that sort of academic world. It hasn't trickled down much to evangelical, Bible Belt Christian folks, as I assume many of us in this room are. So we still are being deprived of the great benefit of the Puritans in general and Edwards in particular, and many people still in our circles continue to have the same impressions of Edwards that are so misguided, they're breathtakingly wrong, and yet at the same time they continue to persist. So we're going to look at Jonathan Edwards this morning. The text of scripture that I'd like to refer you to is one that Edwards himself mentions, and we'll come back to it a little bit later. It's a text of the Apostle Paul, in which Paul is writing to his protege, Timothy, having left Timothy to do continuing ministry in the city of Ephesus. And Paul has gone on to Macedonia, over north of Greece, and he writes this letter of guidance back to Timothy. And in this letter, he makes this remarkable statement. This is in 1 Timothy chapter 1, beginning at verse 15. This is the word of God. "The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But for that very reason, I received mercy, so that in me as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display the utmost patience, making me an example to those who would come to believe in him for eternal life, to the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor, glory, forever and ever. Amen." And then Paul continues with his letter. So in a sense, the benediction is at the beginning. Edwards describes how he was reading that text one day, and as an epiphany, it came to him the powerful truth of God's sovereignty in creation or in salvation. And it changed his whole thinking about it, and we'll see a little bit about how that works a moment later. So let's go ahead and have a word of prayer, and we'll get underway. Our Father, we're grateful for you, to you for the great benefits that are ours. We thank you for the wonderful experiment in constitutional governance that came largely through the Puritans. We thank you for the great wealth of theological insight that came through them, and we especially thank you this morning for this remarkable gift to your people, this character Jonathan Edwards. We pray that our reflection on his life would be filled with appreciation for him, and at the same time, a recognition that he was only a man being used as an instrument of your grace, both in his time and for the benefit of generations to come. We ask that our time in reflecting on this story would be accompanied through your presence and your spirit, so that we as a result will be encouraged in our faith. And for this we give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, well, I'd like to just make a few preliminary preliminary thoughts about Edwards. After Calvin, there were largely two strands of Calvinism. Calvin, of course, mid-1500s, and one of the two principal human sources, you might say, for the Reformation. So we have Luther and the German Reformation that became Lutheranism, and Calvin and what became the Reformed tradition. And the Reformed tradition really branched out into two directions. One came to be called Continental Orthodoxy. Continental Orthodoxy also was sometimes called Protestant Scholasticism. These were largely people in the Calvinistic tradition working in places like Germany and France and elsewhere, who became highly detailed, making what to some people seemed to be pedantic and picayune little distinctions in theological questions that didn't have a lot of bearing on day-to-day life. Now, I think that's being overstated somewhat, but that was the impression many people had. This was called scholasticism because it seemed to have some similarity to medieval scholasticism, in which you hear of theologians sitting around speculating and debating how many angels can dance on the head of a pin, that kind of thing. And it seemed like that's what these sort of scholastics of the post-Protestant or the post-Reformation movement were doing on the continent. They were doing important work, and I'm overselling this point a little bit. I don't personally hold that opinion so much, but certainly if you read them, you're going to be somewhat less than energized. You know, they're really doing some pretty subtle work at a fairly technical level. The other branch, however, of Puritanism that became much more robust was this so-called British and American Puritanism. These people were also doing very important and, I would say, scholarly impressive work, but they were also, for the most part, pastors. Pastors have a problem. No matter how technical their work becomes, they still have to get up and preach on Sunday mornings to ordinary mortals, you see. And so they face this dilemma of having to make it practical, because that's what we want to hear. We come to church for help, for encouragement, for instruction in ways that are accessible to us. And if the pastor is spinning his wheels talking about highly technical points of theology, we start dozing off, you know? And so the Puritans, being aware of this, spent a lot of their time not only doing serious theology, but figuring out a way to communicate it thoughtfully in a manner that was helpful to God's people. Probably the pinnacle expression of this in the Puritan movement, there were many wonderful Puritan preachers and theologians, but I would say probably the most impressive of them, really the highest expression, the zenith of that whole chapter in history, was undoubtedly Jonathan Edwards. Calvin is sometimes called the most controversial character in church history. I would say Edwards may have the same reputation in American history, at least among American Christian leaders. Very deeply caricatured, misunderstood on many different quarters, and yet a man who I think still has largely remains undiscovered. I think the discovery of Edwards may still lie somewhat in the future. From the point of view of Encyclopedia Britannica, they unabashedly declare to this day that he is the greatest theologian, philosopher of American history, period, you see. Funny, a lot of Americans don't know that, but that's the perspective from the outsider looking at him. His work is so profound, so incisive, that it is safe to say that very few people operated at the level of academic genius that he did. He is been the subject of huge interest at Yale University. He graduated from Yale, the valedictorian, as we're going to see as we do a narrative of his life. And after Perry Miller's seminal work, there was a huge interest at Yale in joining in, because of course, Jonathan Edwards was a Yale man, you know. And so they began looking at his writings and realizing that the bulk of what Edwards had written had never been published. The most famous things, of course, were out there, and the one sermon everybody had read was only tiny little piece, just a tiny little particle of the writings of this man. They've now completed a 26-volume series, and each volume, by the way, costs over $100, so if you're thinking of a Christmas present for me, don't even go there. But besides my wife, she would never, you know, I already have too many books. But each volume is 3 inches deep. It is, and these are the writings of Jonathan Edwards, with some degree of commentary for sure, but the bulk of it is his writings. The reason so much of it had been unpublished for so long was that when Edwards did a lot of his writing, he was so impoverished that he had to write in a tiny, minuscule code, a kind of abbreviated English language, and if you looked at it, it just looked like dents writing. One piece of paper to him was cherished. It was a possession that had to be highly valued. Most of us might be 10, 15, 20 pages of material on one sheet writing in this tiny little code, no one even figured out how to read that, you see, until much more recently. So a lot of the task at Yale has been to simply translate Edwards from English into English so that they could publish it, and it's remarkable stuff. And I'd say, you know, the project was only finished, I believe, in the year 2006. So it's only now at a point where you can say scholarly work is beginning to be done to explore the thought of Edwards in a different way than had been available in the past. So just as you know, what we think about Edwards, let's appreciate that we still don't really quite know the story yet. I think in the next 200 years, there may be a huge renaissance of interest in Edwards as people have an opportunity, multiple scholars have an opportunity to think about, debate, explore, triangulate some of his contributions. Even the sermon, Sinners, is both misrepresented and misunderstood. It's misrepresented in this sense. Many people, of course, think that having read that one sermon, that must be sort of the typical genre of Edwards' thought and writing, that all he ever did was bang the pulpit and, you know, scream at people about God's wrath. First of all, keep in mind, he never banged the pulpit once in his life. He read his sermons. He was nearsighted in the extreme. And so he had to hold his manuscript up very close to his eyes. He read in what was described as a high monotone. He was not a pleasant guy to listen to. And he would read the manuscript line by line, and the power of the words themselves had such an impact on people that it led to these emotional reactions. Not because he was being flamboyant or dramatic. Now, George Whitefield, we're going to look at next week, was all of the above. But for Edwards, this was simply an exercise in theological sermonizing, and it was just the power of the content that moved people in this way. This sermon that he preached at Enfield in 1741 during the Great Awakening, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God, was one of the very, very few sermons he ever preached that actually dealt seriously with notions of God's wrath as such. Somebody did a statistical analysis of the writings of Edwards to see what were the words he most frequently used to describe God. What was his favorite adjective to describe God and his character? And you know what the adjective was? The one that far and away was used more by Edwards than any other term was the word sweet. And all through his writings, you see it peppered again and again. He had a personal experience of God through the Holy Spirit that he could only describe as sweet. And that word and many others like it get a lot closer to the way he typically described his understanding of the character of God. Even this sermon, although you have to read it to, you know, kind of with an open mind to see it, because I think many people are recoil, you know, sort of from the images there. Even the sermon is a sermon largely on God's grace. The focus of the sermon is Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. It's the hands of God that are the hands of grace. And his whole point is that you, as if I can play Edwards here for a moment, you, O sinner, here in the presence of God, are only being sustained by his hands that are holding you this moment right now. His sheer mercy is that which keeps you from being exposed to the wrath of God that you so richly deserve. It's his grace which maintains you right now. O sinner, repent. Recognize that it's God's grace that is sustaining you and giving you one more opportunity to turn to him in faith. You see, that was the flavor of the sermon. It's a sermon about grace, but it's also a sermon that realistically assesses the peril of those who repudiate and reject his grace. That there is wrath for sure, but now is a day of salvation, so turn to him. You see, that was kind of the flavor of it. So even that sermon, as unusual as it was still really more about mercy and grace than about wrath, which is the way it's often presented. So anyway, those just kind of a little preliminary thought or two. He was born in 1703. He was the son of Timothy Edwards and Esther Stoddard. Esther Stoddard was the daughter of Solomon Stoddard, who had been the pastor of the Northampton Church in New England for some 55 years. He was sometimes called the Pope of the Massachusetts Valley, not because he was a Catholic, but because his prestige, his influence was so sweeping that it was almost as if he had a kind of papal authority, at least in his moral authority. So Solomon Stoddard was a powerful character. Remember, Massachusetts Bay was founded in 1632. Edwards was born in 1703, so we're a scant 70 years at this point from the beginnings of the Massachusetts Bay experiment. We're into maybe the third or fourth generation now, and the dominant personality through the bulk of that time has been Solomon Stoddard. Massachusetts Bay has been phenomenally successful economically. That Puritan work ethic kicked in a big way, and it's been productive, and there have been fortunes made. And of course, you know that sometimes material success doesn't lead to spiritual acuteness. You know what I'm saying? And so some of these second, third generation products of this Puritan culture were losing a little bit of the sharp edge on their spiritual life, even though they were certainly enjoying the material effects of that traditional Puritan philosophy of hard work and honest work and so on. So Edwards is born into that moment when the Massachusetts Bay experiment is still very successful economically, but has lost a little bit of its spiritual momentum. Now, if we were to jump in a time machine and go back to that, we'd be stunned at how spiritual people really were. But I'm saying by the traditional standards, the culture had begun losing a little bit of its momentum. So anyway, that was the mother of Jonathan Edwards, the daughter of Solomon. So he was, in other words, the grandson of Solomon Stoddard. His father, Timothy, was a brilliant minister. He was Congregational, actually, not Presbyterian. Congregationalism had more or less become equally obvious or pronounced or evident in this culture as well as the Presbyterian presence, maybe even more so. Timothy Edwards was awarded his BA and his MA on the same day from Harvard. He'd done both labors at the same time. He was that kind of student, and so he was given both degrees at once. He started his son Jonathan on serious studies of Latin when Jonathan was six. When most kids are kind of figuring out the ABCs of their own language, Edwards had that under control long ago, and now he's becoming a serious Latin student. By the time he entered college, he had also mastered Greek and Hebrew. So by the time he was 13, he had been homeschooled, of course, by his father all during these years, and was a very competent scholar at the age of 13. And it was at that point that he entered the School of Connecticut, which we know of as Yale University, 13 years of age. At this time, he had a deep and abiding interest in natural science. He was very much impressed with the so-called scientific revolution. He's a contemporary of Isaac Newton. He's aware of Galileo and others of an earlier period. And all of these things had been very, very interesting to him. He was an acute, interested scientist. And if you read his sermons, you find that a great deal of scientific allusion will show up there. And he'll refer to various phenomena of nature to illustrate points in his theological treatises. And it's interesting how he's able to correlate those. Very much like Jesus, of course, in his parables, will often appeal to the surrounding experiences that we have, their common experiences, and uses them, puts them to service to teach things of the truth of God. And Edwards did something of that as well. He also had a considerable interest in philosophy, and so he was kind of a ranging intellect at 13 years old now. This is the kind of mind that he has. There's an essay he wrote. For a long time, people thought he wrote it when he was about 14, and it was just a staggering thought that a 14-year-old could have written it. There's been thought more recently that it may have been as late as 17. I still think it's pretty amazing, but it's a treatise on the flying spider. I teach a course at Whitworth, and one of the characters that we read and look at for a while is Jonathan Edwards, and I always make the students read his essay on the flying spider. It'll make you think all kinds of new thoughts about Jonathan Edwards, you know. Here's a kid who goes out into the forest and watches one little species of spider. that could spin a little web and then use that as a means of transportation. Now, we've all seen that, but he didn't just see it. He studied it acutely and watched it and wrote a quite impressive treatise that was an essay on the flying spider, including illustrations, which you can see. That's Edward's own illustration that I'm showing there on that page, in which he shows how this spider would spin this web and use it and dislodge it and use it for transportation and so on. It's really quite a piece. So another, my point is that he was not simply a guy who was kind of with his head in the clouds. He had a very keen interest in natural science. He was also interested in philosophy, kind of the most probably famous philosopher of the day was still John Locke at this point. Locke died about 20 or 30 years before Edwards was born, probably about 20 years. And John Locke's essay on human understanding was very interesting to Edwards. He read that as a teenager, kind of played with the ideas there. He was very interested in Locke. Also, with respect to Locke's political philosophy, Locke grew up Puritan. He grew up the son of a Puritan attorney. And his dad had fought in the Puritan War, in the Puritan Civil War in England. Locke didn't hold himself out as a Puritan, but certainly reflected that kind of Puritan vision of limited government. And he was, as you probably know, very influential and important in the minds of the framers. He was one of those important philosophers of the time. So Edwards was aware of him, took an interest in him. The Puritans were Calvinists, you know that. I've mentioned that many times. Edwards himself, growing up, had a certain degree of reticence about the Calvinistic view of things. He, as a young man, sort of resisted the notion of God being sovereign in matters of salvation and so on. And he describes his own experience of that, and it incorporates that text of Scripture we were looking at a moment ago. So if you don't mind me reading a little bit from Edwards here, just to illustrate this. He's talking about his own perception as a child of that Calvinistic theology. And he says, quote, "From my childhood, my mind had been full of objections against the doctrine of God's sovereignty and choosing whom he would to eternal life and rejecting whom he pleased, leaving them to eternally perish and be everlastingly tormented in hell. It used to appear like a very horrible doctrine to me. But I remember the time very well when I seemed to be convinced and fully satisfied as to this sovereignty of God and his justice in thus eternally disposing of men according to his sovereign pleasure. My mind rested in it, and it put to an end all those insults and objections. And there had been a wonderful alteration in my mind with respect to God's sovereignty from that day to this, so that I scarcely ever have found so much as the rising of an objection against it in the most absolute sense. In God showing mercy to whom he will show mercy and hardening whom he will, God's absolute sovereignty and justice with respect to salvation and damnation is what my mind seems to rest assured of as much as anything I see with my eyes, at least at so at times." Now, where I know many of you, some of you in this room at least, are probably not Calvinistic in your outlook, so I ask you to just set that aside for a moment, you know, and I'm just trying to illustrate a point here about Edwards. But his, what he is saying here at this point is that in a sense he had been painted into a corner intellectually by the Scriptures. If you read this in its context, he had objected to it, but the more that he read the Scriptures and the more that he digested what seemed to be their content, the more he felt persuaded that this way of thinking of things that came really from Calvin's pen and before him from Luther and before him from Augustine, all of that did seem to reflect a correct understanding of the Scriptures. But if you read this thoughtfully, you get the impression it's sort of a grudging acceptance of it. Okay, okay, I get it. That's what the Bible says. I guess that's what I need to believe. That's kind of the flavor of the writing at this point. And then he continues with this, which I think is intriguing. He says, "I've often since that first conviction had quite another sense of God's sovereignty than I had. I've often since not only had a conviction, but a delightful conviction. The doctrine has very often appeared exceedingly pleasant, bright, and sweet. Absolute sovereignty is what I love to ascribe to God, but my first conviction was not so. The first instance that I remember of that sort of inward, sweet delight in God and divine things that I have lived in much since was on reading those words of 1 Timothy 1:17, "Now unto the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen." As I read the words, there came into my soul, and as it were, diffused through it, a sense of the glory of the divine being. A new sense, quite different from anything I had ever experienced before. Never any words of Scripture seemed to me as these words did. I thought with myself how excellent a being that was, and how happy I should be if I might enjoy that God and be wrapped up to Him in heaven and be, as it were, swallowed up in Him forever. I kept saying, and as it were, singing over these words of Scripture to myself, and went to pray to God that I might enjoy Him, and prayed in a manner quite different than I used to do, with a new sort of affection. Now, what's notable here, and I want you to pay attention to this, because I think it's something we all should be at least aware of in our own kind of spiritual journey. Here's a man who is a great academic and who thinks at a fairly deep level about matters theological, and yet at the same time, his emotions are so powerfully stirred. He sounds almost like a mystic. And that really is very much part of the genre of much of Edwards' writing. He writes profoundly, and yet you realize this is not just a dry operation of a mind, but there's a heart that is constantly engaged in this as well. And he would often break down weeping as he would write some of the truths he was writing about the, you know, God and His work in our lives. So I think that's important to bear in mind with this man, who's often pictured as kind of a dry, crusty, grumpy guy. It really wasn't quite the character of Edwards at all. He does, in much of his writings, describe what almost sounds like the writings of a medieval mystic. You might have read something like this from Bernard of Clairvaux, for example, as opposed to Jonathan Edwards. He says, "This I know not how to express otherwise than by a calm, sweet abstraction of soul from all the concerns of this world, and sometimes a kind of vision for fixed ideas and imagination of being alone in the mountains or some solitary wilderness far from all mankind, privately, sweetly, conversing with Christ, and wrapped up and swallowed up in God. The sense I had of divine things would often of a sudden kindle up, as it were, a sweet burning in my heart, an ardor of soul that I know not how to express." So this is the side of Edwards that a lot of folks aren't so familiar with, a deeply emotional and mystical kind of experience of the presence of God that saturated his life and his preaching. And that was part, I think, of the reason that he had such an impact, not only in terms of academics, but also in his ministry. After he completed his labors at Yale, he spent 2 more years there and got what amounts to a master's in theology. And then from that point on, and for the rest of his career, he was a pastor. He served as an 8-month stated supply, as it's called, in a church in New York. This is when he was fresh out of college. He was about 20 years old at this point. And it was at this time that he generated over about a 2-year period of time, actually, beginning at this moment, his somewhat well-known resolutions. The Puritans were big on resolutions, and they would resolve various principles by which to guide their lives. Resolved, I will be honest in my dealings. Resolved, I will always speak the truth. Resolved, whatever, you know, that kind of thing. Edwards made this a fine art. He had several hundred resolutions, you know, that he wrote for himself when he was 19, 20 years old. I don't believe I have time to run through as many of these as I had hoped, so I'm going to give you a little flavor of them, and I'm going to skip past some of them because time will run out before I have an opportunity to give you all of them. But I want to give you a couple just to give you a flavor for this. Like I say, there's probably about 300 or so resolutions, so I'm just picking and choosing a few here. These he's writing when he's about 19, 20 years old. "Resolved that I will do whatsoever I think to be most to God's glory and my own good, profit, and pleasure. In the whole of my duration, without any consideration of the time, whether now or never so many myriads of ages hence, resolved to do whatever I think to be my duty and most for the good and advantage of mankind in general. Resolved to do this, whatever difficulties I meet with, how many and how great soever. Resolved to be continually endeavoring to find some new invention and contrivance to promote the aforementioned things." Number three, if ever I shall fall and grow dull so as to neglect to keep any part of these resolutions, to repent of all that I can remember when I come to myself again. Number four, never to do any manner of thing, whether in soul or body, more or less, but what tends to the glory of God, nor be nor suffer it if I can avoid it. Number six, to live with all my might while I do live. Number 22, to endeavor to obtain for myself as much happiness in the other world as I possibly can. With all the power, might, vigor, and vehemence, yea, violence, I am capable of or can bring myself to exert in a way that can be thought of. Good works. Number 11, when I think of any theorem in divinity to be solved, immediately to do what I can towards solving it if circumstances don't hinder. 13, to be endeavoring to find out fit objects of charity and liberality. Number 69, always to do that which I shall wish I had done when I see others doing it. Time management. Number 5, never to lose one moment of time, but improve it in the most profitable way I possibly can. Number 7, never to do anything which I should be afraid to do if it were the last hour of my life. 17, that I will live so as I shall wish I had done when I come to die. 37, to inquire every night as I'm going to bed wherein I have been negligent, what sin I have committed, wherein I have denied myself, also at the end of every week, month, and year. I like this one. I frequently hear persons in old age, this is when he's 20 years old now, I frequently hear persons in old age say how they would live if they were to live their lives over again. I don't know how many times I've said that. Resolved that I will live just so I can think I shall wish I had done, supposing I live to an old age. Relationships. Resolved never do anything out of revenge. And believe me, he had opportunities to be filled with a sense of revenge. He was misunderstood in his day as well as in subsequent history. Resolve never to suffer the least motions of anger toward irrational beings, animals. Never to speak evil of anyone so that it shall tend to his dishonor, more or less, upon no account except for some real good. Always to do what I can towards making, maintaining, establishing, and preserving peace, when it can be done without overbalancing detriment in other respects. In narrations, never speak of anything but the pure and simple truth. Never to speak evil of any, except I have some particular good call for doing it. That I will endeavor always to keep a benign aspect and an air of acting and speaking in all places and in all companies, except it should so happen that duty requires otherwise. And the list goes on, but that gives you a flavor. Benjamin Franklin was so impressed with these resolutions of Edwards that he wrote a set of his own. And Franklin was never a Puritan, and we don't even know that he was ever really a Christian, but he was very impressed with the Puritan ethic and that sense of moral virtue that was part of the Puritan ethos. Franklin himself wrote quite a set of resolutions, but he later despaired of the whole exercise because one of his resolutions was to maintain a humble aspect. And then he found that when he kept others of his resolutions, it tended to make him get proud. And he found even that if he'd been humble for a while, he would become proud of his humility. And so he later despaired and said, this is not a working proposition, but I think the difference was that Edwards understood none of these were attainable except through the power of God's presence working in the human heart. It's a nice platitude only until we have something of God's power giving us the strength so to do. When Edwards was had been 8 months at that church in New York, he was called to be the associate pastor to the Northampton Church there in Northampton, and to labor under his grandfather, Solomon Stoddard. And so he took that job, and that was really where he worked out his career for the next several years. It was at that time when he just came to the church that he married young woman, 17 years old, which was, by the way, not unusual age-wise at that time in history, whose name was Sarah Pierpont. I think he'd been Twitter-pated over Sarah for some years, but at this point, they marry. He had written an interesting little piece that he called his apostrophe to Sarah when she was only 13. And of course, he would at that time have been about 17 himself. And so this is his little description when he's writing, when he's 17, writing concerning this young woman, 13 years old, very famous little piece from Jonathan Edwards. Quote, "They say there is a young woman, young lady, in New Haven, who is beloved of that almighty being who made and rules the world, and that there are certain seasons in which this great being, in some way or other invisible, comes to her and fills her mind with exceeding sweet delight, and that she hardly cares for anything except to meditate on him, that she expects after a while to be received up where he is, to be raised up out of the world and caught up into heaven, being assured that he loves her too well to let her remain at a distance from him always. There she is to dwell with him and be ravished with his love and delight forever. Therefore, if you present all the world before her with the richest of its treasures, she disregards it and cares not for it and is unmindful of any pain or affliction. She has a strange sweetness in her mind and a singular purity in her affections, is most just and conscientious in all her actions, and you could not persuade her to do anything wrong or sinful if you were to give her all the world, lest she should offend this great being. She's of a wonderful sweetness, calmness, and universal benevolence of mind, especially after those seasons in which this great God has manifested himself to her mind. She will sometimes go about from place to place, singing sweetly, and seems to be always of joy and pleasure, and no one knows for what. She loves to be alone, to wander in the fields and on the mountains, and seems to have someone invisible always conversing with her." Edwards' apostrophe to Sarah Pierpont. Sarah and Jonathan Edwards married when he first came to the church. There's a wonderful biography of Sarah Pierpont written by Elizabeth Dodds, D-O-D-D-S, readily available. It's entitled Marriage to a Difficult Man. And it's a wonderful treatment of her life. She was quite a remarkable woman in her own right. She was proud, she granted to a fault many times of her remarkable and famous husband, but she was also a highly competent Christian thinker and person in her own right who certainly deserves a certain amount of the credit for his success, and I think Edwards would have been the first to acknowledge that. Stoddard died in 1727, and that's when Edwards became the pastor then of the Northampton Church. He was concerned about the spiritual life in New England by this point. As I say, we're now about three or four generations into the Puritan experiment. The great financial benefits of the Puritan work ethic have been richly realized. But some of the spiritual sharp edge, as I said earlier, has been lost. And Edwards was deeply worried about this as he began his ministry in earnest now that his grandfather was dead. And so he began preaching along those lines, trying to reinvigorate some vision for a true and deep commitment to Christ in a person's life, and it actually began to have some effect about 1732 with the beginnings, kind of the harbinger of what came to be called the Great Awakening. Edwards was fascinated by this and somewhat surprised by it because he was not, as I say, a flamboyant preacher, and it wasn't as if people were drawn to him because he had an electrifying personality in the pulpit or any such thing, but he did try to preach faithfully about a life of devotion to Christ and obedience to his word and the kind of Christian discipline that engenders growth and so on. And quite unexpectedly, even to him, there did seem to be kind of an explosion of what might be called revival, a kind of awakening. And he was so interested in it, and the scientist in him immediately began to put this under a microscope, you know, and he started examining it and thinking about it, what's going on here, and he tried to, more or less in a detached and almost clinical way, come to an understanding of it, and it became the basis for some of his most famous publications. This book I recommend, a divine and supernatural light. It is a wonderful, readable discussion of what Edwards was seeing in the beginnings of the Great Awakening in New England at that time, published in 1734. He also wrote another work a couple of years later, a faithful narrative of the surprising work of God. He was as surprised as anybody as he began to see the evidence of God moving in this community and awakening people to a new fervor in their devotion to Christ. From outside came accusations. This is emotionalism. This is fanaticism. These people are over the top. There were, of course, folks outside that region and even some within it who viewed this as not a legitimate expression of God's work, but simply a kind of over-the-top froth, you might say. And so that began to come in. And then to make matters worse, there was a suicide. And one of the people who had been apparently touched by this revival actually took his own life. Edwards was stunned and horrified and began to rethink everything that had happened. And again, he had to think it through and work it through. This was probably the low point of his whole career when this took place. There was kind of a quiet period for a couple of years, and then George Whitefield came to town. I want to look at George Whitefield's career next week. He is a wonder of his age. And I don't want to say more about it because I'll steal time that I have very little of right now. But anyway, that did reinvigorate the Great Awakening. And I think you'd say the Great Awakening in America was largely the result of, humanly, of these two men, George Whitefield and Jonathan Edwards, and their joint efforts in various parts of the American world at that point. It was in 1741, in the midst of this, that Edwards preached his famous sermon, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God, preached it at Enfield, and the effect on the audience was absolutely amazing, as people were moved to tears, and he had to stop several times in the midst of the sermon and ask people to quiet down so he could continue, you know, reading his manuscript. But they were so touched and moved and convicted by the work of God's Spirit there that it was virtually all he could do just to get through this sermon at that time. And it, of course, was reprinted many, many times. He also wrote at this time Marks of the Work of God's Spirit. He also wrote Thoughts on the Revival in New England. These are all publications that are intended to analyze what was going on. What was this Great Awakening? And he views it with the genius observational powers of a theological scientist. He's trying to understand it. But probably the most famous work of all is called Religious Affections. And lest you think that these are just obscure pieces, this is out there. It's readily available. You cannot borrow this one. No. But you can get it by the end of the day. You see, it's this was published a few years ago, the intro by Charles Colson, and it's been published and republished. What it is an attempt to digest what are the marks of a true work of God's Spirit and what are not marks of God's Spirit. Edwards, for example, says, crying could be, but does not necessarily, a mark that God is at work. Certain things are true and legitimate marks of God's work, and certain things are simply neutral. They may or may not indicate anything. And he goes through rather incisively in a way that I think is of great help to every Christian who's interested in such a topic. So anyway, I recommend those writings, especially that'd be a good place to start, Religious Affections by Jonathan Edwards. Interestingly, toward the end of his career at Northampton, Jonathan Edwards publicly disagreed with a position that had been taken by Solomon Stoddard on a certain point related to partaking of the Lord's Supper. I'm not going to take time to describe it. It was what Stoddard called the halfway covenant. And it had been part of Stoddard's teaching. And in some ways, you would say by the gauge of the time, it made Stoddard a little bit of a liberal. And Edwards was always uncomfortable with it, but didn't feel like he had the kind of the, you know, horsepower to take on his grandfather and this man who had been such a prominent and dominating personality. But finally, coming up to about the year 1750, he did finally publicly challenge this particular part of Stoddard's teaching. It got him in so much trouble at the Northampton Church that he would challenge Solomon Stoddard that they fired him. And so Edwards was fired from the Northampton Church in 1751, one of the most famous men in America. But because of the disgruntledness that he would actually dispute something Stoddard had taught, they let him go. He preached a very moving sermon, a parting sermon. It was not filled with bitterness at all. It was just a farewell and wishing them well and so on. He was given multiple offers all across the country to come and take over ministries elsewhere. He declined all of them and moved about 50 miles down the road to Stockbridge, Massachusetts. And Stockbridge was largely a village inhabited by Housatonic Indians. And he became a school teacher. And I think one of the most amazing ironies of the whole career of Edwards is that he went and basically taught beginning children, mostly Native American children in this community, the ABCs, basic education. He was a school teacher. And then at the end of the day, he went home and wrote some of the most brilliant philosophical writing that the world has ever produced. And he wrote it in that very minuscule code that I was talking about, and much of it has only been in recent years, actually. Much of it was available at the time, but much more of it was simply more or less buried in obscurity for many years. His wife describes how the only recreation he would ever give himself was to go horseback riding. He was not a man of robust health, and so he would go out for a horseback ride. And she says when he came back, he would always look like he'd been through a snowstorm because he would carry a little bundle of papers with him, scraps of paper, candy wrappers, you know, that kind of thing. And as he would think of things, he would stop and write down little notes to himself, kind of like Pascal's pensées. He would write these little tiny notes and then pin it to his garment, you see. And so by the time he got back from a typical horseback ride, he has these little pieces of paper pinned all over his garments. And Sarah looked at him and thought, you know, where have you been? You know, the North Pole or what? But anyway, all of this has been gradually accumulated. And so it's really interesting. Some of it rather random, miscellanies of various kinds, but fun reading. This is what he did during those years. And so some of the great philosophical work. And he did, you would say in philosophical terms, he was sort of like a guy with the empirical interest of a true scientist who nevertheless had a fundamentally Platonic outlook. And of course, deep in all of that was his Christian conviction. So he's done amazing philosophical work that I think still is a subject of some interest and will be for some time to come. He was very interested in the practice of inoculating against disease. And this was the time when the smallpox vaccination was just being developed. And in the interest of developing that, he offered to be vaccinated himself against smallpox. Unfortunately, he contracted smallpox and died in 1758 as a result, just after he had been offered and accepted the position of president of the College of New Jersey, which became Princeton. And so he was offered that job, he accepted it, but never was able to take that position because he died in the meantime. There have been multiple biographies, as you can imagine, of Jonathan Edwards over the years. One, George Martson, says this of Edwards: the Edwards family produced produced scores of clergymen, 13 presidents of basically of universities, 65 professors, and many other persons of notable achievements. There are, of course, descendants of Jonathan Edwards among us to this day in our country, and some have had notable careers. I mentioned earlier that Perry Miller at Harvard was really largely responsible for this renaissance of interest. As far as I know, Perry Miller was certainly no, you know, Bible-banging fundamentalist. I'm not sure he was a Christian at all. I don't know his heart or anything like that. He wasn't coming from that perspective. He was writing strictly out of absolute fascination with the man's genius. And this was kind of what revised the whole appreciation of him, was when he began to discover some of the work that Edwards had done that had been largely neglected all through the years. As I mentioned, Yale University has published his works in 26 volumes, and it's been a project that lasted about 3 decades. So my hope is that this is going to be the catalyst, not my presentation, but this entire interest in Edwards is going to be the catalyst for all kinds of new interest in him, and that we may, over the next 200 or 300 years, when we're all still going to be here in Sunday school, aren't we? We're going to be able to see where some of this has gone. I mentioned to you at the beginning Edwards' kind of transforming moment when he read this verse, and I want to leave it with you as well, because I do think personally that if there's any word we need as contemporary Christian people. I'm not saying about you in this class so much, because I think you distinguish yourself as brilliant Christian people. But the culture of evangelical Christianity across America today strikes me as narcissistic in the extreme. That we are all wrapped up in what makes me feel good. And Jesus is just a kind of feel-good potion. It's what can he do for me? And it does seem to me that the thing that really inspires true, deep, authentic, credible Christian devotion is not so much being wrapped up in me, but being wrapped up in God. And Edwards really does call us back to cherishing and appreciating and recognizing the great God, immortal, invisible, the creator of all things, the one before whom we are but dust, and yet God in his grace has given us this remarkable privilege to be in his presence. And that is that and only that which really does, as Augustine said, fill that vacuum that's within us. And I think Edwards helps us appreciate that and discover it, and certainly reading the things he's written, I believe, will lead you in that direction.